Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Coast to coast, pole to pole, all around the world on the internet, thanks to the marvel of technology. I am coming at you live from a little guest house in Memphis, Tennessee. This is Keith Anthony Blanchard, and you are listening to Center of Light Radio, Center of Divine Unfoldment and Reinforcement Radio for the soul. The music you hear before all of these broadcasts is my spiritual group called Lavender Soul. It's been a while since we put out an album, and maybe that can happen really soon. Welcome to the show. It's Monday night. I can't think of a better way to start the week than being flooded with light and positivity. And tonight we're going to have a guest who's going to teach us all about the pineal gland and a couple other really, really cool things that she was able to be a part of in her growing up. Last Tuesday night, I've been looking at social media for the last couple of weeks, and I've been seeing tons of posts about people who are had this awful anxiety and have for many years. And, you know, we see people here or there who may have such things, but my stream was being flooded. So I decided to do a Facebook live streaming event for an hour called No More Anxiety No More. And wow, I woke up the next morning and had over 700 views, and this thing has continued to climb. And so I decided I'm going to do this hopefully at least once a week, and my next one's going to be meditation. It's not what you think. 7 o'clock, and if you have any interest in checking out this live broadcast, Burst of Light live feed, you can go to facebook.com/KeithAnthonyBlanchard at 7 p.m. Central Time, and you will see the live feed, and I will wait for about 5 minutes so the room can fill up with people. I have a fantastic presentation for you. Lots of the dialogue is going to come from my bestseller, The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, as well as I have a slideshow presentation ready and a phenomenal 30-minute meditation by Sadhguru, a God-realized man who is from India, and he is kind of like the rave right now. So hello, everyone in the chat room, Daria, Dana, Klaatu, wow, it's been a while since I've seen you. And Starlight, appreciate your presence. I'm sure more people's going to be piling in here shortly. Still no word from Nucleus 8, my alien humid hybrid friend. He's going to come through. I know him very well. If you go to Center of Light Radio, centeroflightradio.com, on the opening page, you'll see a subscription form. Fill it out. And the next thing or so, I'm going to be sending out my January, February, March. We're in March. March newsletter program. Fill out that subscription form. Not only will you have access to, it's free, my monthly newsletter installment, which I do all the research, and I put many, many hours into what it is I'm looking for to bring you quality content, information that will empower you as it does me. That's just my gig. I love empowering people. It fills me inside knowing that I'm living a purposeful, blissful life. And if there's something you want me to research in any particular field of spirituality, or let's just say out of the box thinking, heck, it can even be about health, something you've discovered that everyone wished they had that information, tell me about it. I will do this research, and I will follow that rabbit into the hole as far as possible. But also, you will have access to my RPM program, my lifelong work, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. If you are a YouTuber like I am, go to YouTube and look up Center of Light Radio. Leave me a comment in the box if there's a particular archive show that you just really wild by. It helps me to refine my future guests. And also, give me a thumbs up whenever you can. It's all appreciated. Services, as you know, if you're a repeat person here, you know that I do services. I do life-changing presentations for many years all over. I can speak about any field of spirituality, ascension, and all that cool stuff, but I also had a lifetime of experiences of hanging out with others, meaning people who are not of this world, aliens, if that's the word you choose. I can cater to your theme. If you're having boogeymen in your house and they're causing you nothing but trouble, I can empower you with an arsenal of information that will raise the vibration of you, your home, your family unit, and that way your house and everything in it, including your loved ones, can get back to the happy home that you desire and deserve. And for any of these services, you can reach me at KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. come and let me know what particular service you are looking for. And all these services are listed on Center of Light Radio. It's time to get down to Center of Light Radio business. Today on Center of Light Radio, my guest is Heather Sartain, and we will be discussing one of my favorite subjects, cosmic awareness, a small step towards a giant leap of mind. Heather Sartain comes forward sharing inside, listen to this now, very, very good stuff. She comes forward sharing inside information from her father, a former NASA aerospace engineer, during four decades of evolving space flight. She is a mother of two and an adjunct professor of physics and geology while committed to her career in science and technology. Heather's hobbies include writing, photography, stargazing, traveling, and mineral therapy. She currently is writing three books. The first two explain evolution and our DNA by Earth's catastrophic events, geomagnetic reversals, and extraterrestrial intervention. In them, she provides scientifically supported evidence utilizing the changes in human blood types as a foundation for understanding DNA changes in the first book titled Blood Type Evolution and Earth's Catastrophic Events. The second book, Blood Type Evolution and Extraterrestrial Intervention. Heather once again uses blood type DNA as a foundation for how extraterrestrials intervene with the DNA coding of the living things on this planet. Her third book in progress, Pineal Gland Devolution, Heather explains how our pineal gland, a vital organ for communication, spiritual growth, and manifestations, has been devolving from a harmful process of toxin exposure introduced by them, our government, by the reptilian race. Heather and her children have dealt with many extraordinary events, unusual encounters, paranormal activity, and vivid, realistic dreams, encountering beings from other dimensions. I'm not sure what contact source Heather would like me to give out, so we'll let her do that here in just a little bit, because she doesn't have a website. So, all that being said, Heather Sartain, welcome to Center of Light Radio.
Thank you, Keith.
You're absolutely welcome. I'm glad you're here. If we can, let's start talking about your early childhood life with your father being in the NASA program. Can you just start off with that, if you would?
Well, my early childhood life, he used to bring me a toy every Friday, and sometimes it was things like trucks. And I say that jokingly because in my early childhood, my experiences with my father were, playful and, he was a part of my life every day. As I got older, he, would have conversations in our home, either with my mom or with colleagues from work, friends from work that I was exposed to. So for several years growing up, I was exposed to conversations. But as I got older and became a teenager, I did start asking questions, usually when I heard him talking about something and I'd ask him about it at some point in time, or if it was just him and my mom talking, I would ask him, what are you guys talking about, these aliens and stuff? And as I got older, he respected my maturity and education and started to explain it to me a little bit, but he always made sure that I understood this isn't something you're going to go and share with your friends or anybody at school. Just keep it to yourself. It's somewhat top secret information. And the real top secret stuff that my dad was involved in, after recently talking with a colleague that's still living, these guys are never going to reveal this information. They are under strict contract. Their lives are at stake. I've confirmed that with one of his ex-colleagues that happens to be involved in my current work in aerospace technology. I do sell components to the aerospace industry, and he's one of my customers. He has explained to me there is a security clearance above Department of Defense that these guys had to adhere to. And the public is not aware of it. It's not publicized information at all. Even the security clearances, we don't hear about.
Is this part of like the Majestic clearances, Majestic on up to Majestic 12, that Bush supposedly had? Is this the particular hierarchy that you're speaking about?
Yeah, yeah. I don't know the particular names of the type my father may have had. He never spoke of it.
When you were listening in to some of these conversations that your father was having, be it with colleagues or whoever it may be, how did this strike you? Like, oh yeah, Dad, I already know that intuitively. Yeah, I get all that. Or did it just seem like my dad's just hanging out with some of his friends talking about this weird stuff?
Some of it did seem strange to me, especially when I could comprehend it. The alien stuff that I heard, like himself and my mom talk about, because she did have a close UFO encounter with my sister in hand. And that just became like normal to me. Hearing about extraterrestrials and knowing that they exist, probably since the age of around, I'm going to say 10, I just thought that was everyday life stuff. You know, no, I didn't go around talking about it. I did talk to my friends a little bit. You know, what do you think about aliens? You know, they exist. And they're like, yeah, whatever. But my friends knew me as being very different. And so the ones that grew to love me, you know, they respected things that I did share with them. And, you know, it's not everyday talk anyway, especially growing up in the 80s. These weren't topics among friends of that age. As I asked my father questions as I got older, he would explain to me the different types of aliens. And he said, you know, this is all true. The government's been aware of it for quite some time now. It's not new information. My mom had explained to me in the 1960s, he was explaining to her that there were hybrids among us, that there were many of them, and they don't come from other star systems necessarily. They're here, residing here on this planet. There are certain alien types that live on this planet currently and have been since probably the 1920s or 40s, I'm assuming. But a lot of the talks I was exposed to come from alien abductions. They come from crashes, especially the famous Roswell crash that we all know to be true. The kind of things my father was involved in, based on information from a couple of colleagues I talked to, one worked directly for NASA for over 40 years. The other person worked with the same contractor my dad was with at one time, was Bendix, then later on was Lockheed Martin. And they worked on reverse engineering of some of these crashes. They also worked on technology that was found in the UFO technology. So mechanisms that control the machine, not just flight, but also control panel type stuff. And I know that that information will not be revealed. I did not have discussions about technology with my father.
Wow. It's truly refreshing to hear someone like you bring information forth that many of us already agree to, believe, probably intuitively know is real. Because I have a lot of guests and have heard many of interviews of people who are, quote, experts in the field, who have the same kind of knowledge that most people have. But to hear someone like you coming from a family with someone like your dad in it that has firsthand information say these things, it's a different vibration altogether. It's a different delivery altogether. So did your dad ever tell you any more? And we don't have to stay on this subject if it's something that you just don't want to continue, and I understand. Did your dad ever tell you about what is going on the dark side of the moon?
He did to some degree. Without going into a grand amount of detail, I had talks with him later in my 20s. We used to have meetings with a friend of ours on Monday nights, and we would get together and everybody would bring like kind of like a potluck, and we would have spiritual/scientific meetings. And it consisted of my father, my mother, myself, a really good friend of ours, and whoever wanted to come. And we had a small group, and my dad talked about things that I already knew about at these meetings. that I had heard in our household. But after a time of being retired from Lockheed Martin, he opened up a little bit more, mostly in regards to extraterrestrials. The extraterrestrials that most people have abduction experiences with, the ones that my mother saw in a UFO encounter that she had in 1966, and the ones that are most famously seen and drawn by artist depictions, are the grays. And my father said more than once that those are not really a type of spiritual being like us. They are, in fact, programmed robots like androids. They have a biological suit, but it has a lot of problems once it enters the Earth's atmosphere and pressure and the conditions that we have on this planet. However, they're controlled by another ancient alien race, and not all of their agenda is good. A lot of it is not good. And he did explain to me there are different types of grays. I know for sure of two types because we talked about a taller race versus a shorter race. And it's my understanding from him that the shorter grays, the ones that are child size, are most responsible for reptilian abduction-based experiments and interfering with human DNA.
So would it be fair to say, just as a way of describing, short gray bad, tall gray good?
I'm not going to be 100% on that, but...
The reason I brought that up is because my alien-human hybrid friend, Nucleus 8, he's gray and half-human, and he's actually head of security for this quadrant of our galaxy, and he's a really, really cool dude. So I was just trying to put those together as acknowledgement or validation that at least the part of his grayness came from something good, benevolent, versus the malevolent side of whatever particular race that we might be talking about here.
Right, right. Now I understand. This is information that I know I've heard my dad speak of more than once, and it's my understanding from him that the smaller version of the grays have been heavily controlled by another race. And I'd known that race to be the reptilian race. He did tell me that the reptilians are real. I remember laughing when I was about 18 or 19 and having a conversation. So you're telling me that there's aliens that look like lizard, basically. And he said, oh, yeah, they exist. And I'm like, well, where do they come from? And he said, another star system. And I said, well... Do they have like arms and legs? Do they stand up or do they crawl around like a lizard? And he said, no, they kind of look like us, I guess, you know, he told me he didn't know how big they were. He's, you know, it's not like he's had contact that, or even maybe I should say contact that he would recall with a reptilian and to remember their size. But I remember he kind of described them to me as having scaly skin and, you know, they don't have hair like we do. They're definitely reptilian. And he said, they're definitely bad. Just remember that. They're really, really bad guys.
Many people who play in this arena would say that these reptilians, the draconians, that they're actually the demons or the devils that they speak about in biblical scripture.
Right.
Makes sense to me. They're bad. They look lizard-like.
Exactly. Like if you go back to Genesis, and we all know the story of the snake who opened up, you know, Eve to the tree of knowledge and was really sneaky about it. I mean, what can I say?
Sure.
A very manipulative race. My dad told me they're definitely intelligent. They have a lot of knowledge, and they have been working with the government and sharing that knowledge. And I remember one time he told me, what better way to ruin our human society than to teach them how to ruin themselves? And that's what they do.
Wow. So they could just stay behind the scenes and just watch it all unfold.
Yeah. And I understand there to be some kind of law or rule governing that they don't directly, it's not like they're going to show up and like laser all of us, kill us all. it's more deep than that. It's more complex, and it's, you know, I'm giving you the knowledge to harm yourself, and I'm teaching the worst, most manipulative people on your planet how to do this with them having the characteristics that we have. And that is to manipulate and to cause harm. There are people who have contact with reptilians, and as a result, they get gifts out of this.
Oh, sure. I would expect so. You know, people think that the Russians were first in space. We were first on the moon. From my research, and I'm sure you chased those rabbits in the hole as well, being your dad, the person he was, and just being around such knowledge, that the Germans were first in space. And this happened like in the 20s, that they were the first to make, not only the first in space, but to make contact with the Dracos or the reptilians. Hence the reason why we saw, you might, if you get on Google Images and look up the German spacecraft, you'll find what I think was called the German Bell. And then Hitler was supposedly never died. He never put a pistol in his mouth. He took off to South America. And the movie Indiana Jones is not so far-fetched that the reason the Germans had to be stopped, because they were searching for either the Ark of the Covenant or some particular vessel that housed a Christed soul. And they believed that if they got their hands on it, they could level the entire world with control.
No, exactly. There's a lot of information revealed from Hollywood in the movies. It's from my understanding, from some of the meetings I attended, not just with my father, but a good friend of ours who did a lot of research on some of these very same topics, how this information is revealed to the public. I understand that there is some type of galactic law where that has to be in place. And it has a lot to do with evil. So the evil things that some humans in our government are involved in as a direct result of communications with the reptilians have to adhere to revealing some of that information, but they can do it almost like the fine print that you might find in a contract that you really don't want to read.
That's really, really spooky. One final thought about this particular subject, and Heather, we can move on if you like, because there's a lot more I would like to cover with you, which is the DNA and the pineal gland and all that other really cool stuff, is the fact that supposedly right now there is a no-fly zone over Antarctica. And I may be incorrect about that, but the more pertinent point is that there is supposedly a war right now in Antarctica, an actual battle between humanity and particular races of being that are trapped here and cannot get out.
Okay.
I just thought that you might have been privy to this information, being that you're so well diverse in all these fields.
Well, I am definitely aware that for many, many years, things have been going on in Antarctica. We've had a research facility there for decades. There actually has been a child born, the first citizen of Antarctica, probably 10 years ago. And there has been a lot of research under, you know, the cover up of, you know, tapping in for oil, so oil and gas research, and also core sampling for climate research going on in Antarctica. But there's a lot of other research going on there that is not, you know, in the public eye.
Center of Life Radio. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard, your host, Mondays, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. I am here. Tonight, my guest is Ms. Heather Sartain, and we're talking about lots of really, really cool stuff. Heather, we're almost at the bottom of the hour. Boy, time does fly. Would you give out, do you have any contact information that you would like to share with our audience and how they can find out more about you and what you're doing?
Certainly. I do have a Facebook page. I don't have a website. I should probably create one. However, if you just search my name, last name is Sartain, you can find me on Facebook. And that's probably the best way to get in touch with me. I do check it periodically, at least, you know, for 5 minutes once a day.
I did a little research to try to find a contact on you. And I think her address is facebook.com/heather.sartain.92. Keith Anthony Blanchard here with Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio, look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. Heather, let's move on to the topic of the show. Let's talk about the pineal gland. Tell us about the pineal gland, what has been done to it, and what purpose does it serve when it's fully functioning and balanced?
The pineal gland is a very small gland that sits centered in the brain, right between your eyebrows. So if you were to find that perfect center between your eyebrows, it's situated between the two hemispheres of the brain. It has functionality like our normal eyes, except it's way more advanced than that. So our eyes are designed to see a small portion of the light spectrum measured in nanometers because the wavelength is so small in that section. Coming from the sun, we have every part of the light spectrum. All stars emit certain parts of the light spectrum at certain intensities. And starlight that you see in the sky will give you all parts of the light spectrum. But the only part that we see is the 400 to 700 nanometer range. So that's going to be from the red to the purple, and the purple being 400 nanometers and the red being 700. The pineal gland is equipped to function as a gland or organ that can actually pick up and receive information through light of the spectrum of longer and shorter wavelengths. It can handle shorter wavelengths, and it's not damaging. It's not damaging to our body. Obviously, we're still here, and we get all kinds of radiation to us and the planet. Some of it is purposeful. Some of it is not. It's a communication organ that we use to communicate with other dimensions and other beings that we cannot see. So just because we cannot see something surrounding us doesn't mean it's not there. We have dimensions that are layers upon layers. In other words, two different things, multiple different things can occupy the same space at the same time, but you don't know it and you don't feel it necessarily. But through the pineal gland, you can.
Heather, are you familiar with the practice of sun gazing? And if so, does that have an effect on the pineal gland to activate it?
Exposure to our sun? Definitely.
There's a practice of staring at the sun. And of course, it takes the responsibility and knowledge to do this because you don't want to burn out your retina. But supposedly that as you sun gaze and you increase your practice with this, that it begins to open up the pineal gland. And not only that, if you do this correctly for a certain length of time, you can actually wean yourself off of eating food because you're getting your nourishment directly from the sun, which grows the crops in the field and you're taking it in that way. But are you familiar with that practice?
Oh, yeah. I'm definitely familiar with types of meditation in which you can bring your body and your DNA to a point of receiving energy from sunlight instead of food.
It's kind of like cutting out the middleman, meaning that you no longer need to eat vegetables or if you eat meat or whatever it is, because everything naturally comes alive due to the sun is life-giving to all of that which is on the earth. So if you cut out the middleman, come directly to the source, yeah?
Yeah, With help of meditation, and your pineal gland is very open to meditation. In fact, I want everyone to understand that the more you meditate, the more you practice meditation and you're truly dedicated to those moments when you are practicing the meditation, that will help heal your pineal gland more than anything else you could possibly do. There's a lot of physical things you could do that physiologically affect the pineal gland and kind of help cleanse the pineal gland, but meditation is obviously the key. I've been practicing meditation for over 10 years, and I can say 100% without a doubt, you can check my medical records. I never get sick anymore.
Yeah. And I don't either. I think the last episode of anything I had was the flu about 3.5 years ago, and it came in and went out. But I don't get sick. I just don't. So, Heather, let's talk a little bit, and I'm sure many people out there in Inception Radio Network land, as well as people who just come across this show as well as Inception and stumble on this show that way. But we've all heard about the horrible effects that fluoride has on the pineal gland. And that's truly rat poison, and it's sodium fluoride. And tell me some more about that.
Yes, don't even get me started.
I
share this information with students at the university. And, you know, it is incredible when I lecture to students and I'm totally mainstream and by the textbook. And there'll be things about theories that we've been taught for, you know, a couple of hundred years or so. And I start to get irritated. And I'm like, you want to hear about some other theories? Because remember what I told you a theory is? It's not fact. It's based on observations. So let me tell you about this fluoride stuff. First of all, why would our government be so concerned about our cavities when they're not concerned enough about our healthcare system and a whole lot of other things?
Bingo.
So I love this conversation because several years ago, I was working with one of our operators at a company in which I was working in technical sales for a corrosion inhibitor used in refineries. And him and I used to go and do surveys together in refineries. And he was telling me how he used to work for the public waterworks system in Pasadena, Texas. And it was back in the 80s. And he said, Heather, they had me putting more and more sodium fluoride into the city water. We would get bags of this white powder, and it says right on the bag, poisonous, with the crossbones and everything, very toxic. And we had to be careful in exposure with it. And he said he started asking questions. You know, why are they okay? So they've increased the amount of sodium fluoride we're adding, but the water usage has increased, but our tank size hasn't. So the dilution of this stuff, the amount in parts per million has increased. And he said, it just boggled his mind. You know, this is poison. Why are we putting this in the water? And I asked him, well, what did they tell you? What was the answer they gave you? And he said, well, they told me it was to kill bacteria.
Yeah, right.
Okay. And he said they did say it was to prevent cavities. Like, that's like the big talk about the sodium fluoride, is to prevent cavities. And I said, right. Well, the chlorine that they put in city water is the main ingredient that kills bacteria. The fluoride is not. If you do your own research and you read about this stuff, you'll find tons of information where the government's saying, oh, it's to protect your teeth from cavities. You know, we did all these studies in the past and we found out in cities and, you know, municipalities, these, you know, children growing up had less cavities when there was fluoride in the water. It's all total BS. Sodium fluoride is a free radical. It's like chlorine. These are also harmful to our atmosphere from photochemical reactions. They call them chlorofluorocarbons. Notice chloro and fluoro represent chlorine and fluorine. In the atmosphere, they break down ozone layer. They are terrible in the presence of oxygen. They want to take oxygen and become compounds of oxygen. They're extremely harmful to the pineal gland, but not just the pineal gland. Sodium fluoride is a really bad substance for your thyroid and your thyroid functionality. It's terrible for the blood. It's terrible for all the cells of the body. When you go to the dentist, I know they give you fluoride. Think about it. You're rinsing your mouth with a chemical that is extremely toxic. It's a bit more concentrated in the rinse they give you at the dentist. The dentist has no idea he's giving his patients poison and that it's bad for them. That's not what they're taught in their practice. They're told that it prevents cavities. But there are studies in Europe and Asia showing it does nothing for cavity prevention.
And if you have enough, going to say that the Japanese people did banish that from their system, and nothing has happened with it, more prevalent of cavities or less. It's just total hogwash.
Yeah, so you're rinsing your mouth with a liquid and you spit it out. So you rinse it around for, I don't know, 30 seconds. I remember doing this when I was a kid. And you spit it out and, you know, your mouth tastes terrible. So then you rinse it out with water, you drink something later. The fluoride has now gotten into your bloodstream. Yeah, they'll tell you it gets into the cracks and crevices of your teeth. And what is it? Is it going to stay there forever? No, it is in and out. Your teeth are not an environment for fluoride. The fluoride wants to be in the blood. It goes to the pineal gland. It calcifies the pineal gland over time. During the process of calcification, the pineal gland starts to lose functionality. The production of DMT, which is responsible for our dreams and the dream state and connection to the spirit world or other dimensions, becomes less and less prominent. And if you notice, do you ever have friends or you ever talk to somebody about dreams and you hear people say, oh, I don't ever dream. I don't remember my dreams. There are lots and lots of people who can't remember their dreams, or it seems like they didn't have any while they were sleeping. That's the pineal gland starting to lose some of its functionality. That's an example.
You know, Heather, I've had people in the past tell me, well, Keith, you don't swallow the toothpaste. Well, of course you don't swallow the toothpaste. But being a radionics vibrational healer, I know that just by having it in your mouth, and many people will tell you this, doctors will tell you this, the fastest inlet into the body is under the tongue. That's why when you do certain sublingual things that go into the tongue, because it's the fastest inlet to the body. Just the very fact that you have this in the mouth for however long, the absorption process begins immediately.
Oh, yeah, it does. And so I'm like the mom who comes to the dentist with my kids and he's like, yeah, no fluoride, right? Yeah, right. No fluoride. And I mean, we don't get it. I haven't had it in several years and I certainly don't expose my children to it. Now, I can say this. Don't feel bad if you've gone to the dentist even recently and had a fluoride rinse. That's not a ton of exposure. You can still get through this. Stop exposing yourself as much as you can. I know filtration systems are expensive, but if you use alumina filters, and alumina is kind of like clay, it's a fine particle, it's a mineral, it's naturally occurring. It has the ability, it has active bonding sites on it to bond with fluoride and pull it out of the water. So you want the right type of filtration. Carbon filtration is not going to remove fluoride. So it's important to have the right type of material to get that stuff out of your water. And be careful when purchasing water. Some companies have fluoride intentionally put into the drinking water. One of those companies that I know for sure is Ozarka, and they actually advertise fluoride in some of the water as a choice. You can buy bottles of fluoride water. People think that's good for them.
Heather, that's a lot of powerful information. Let's talk about DNA code. Are we robots?
You know, I've wondered. I've definitely wondered. Yeah. Okay. Yes. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. I think that you can still be a spiritual being and have a body or suit designed for the planet that you live on that is based on code. So it's like, just think of your suit as a robot. It doesn't mean that your spirit is. You're just residing in this suit that's designed to handle the elements and the environment of this planet, the pressures, the atmospheric conditions, and everything else that's in this planet, in this density. So genetic engineers will tell you, oh, it's really easy to program DNA. It's like you just sit down at a computer and you rewrite code. It's that simple. You don't have to be a genetic engineer to do this. However, genetic engineers are now proving that through the change in the DNA code, cells begin to change. The replication of functions in cells starts to be by RNA, which we call messenger RNA, starts sending that message out. So these cells start to be rebuilt in a certain way. We as humans now have the knowledge to reprogram DNA to accept changes in the environment and still survive. So doesn't that make us a DNA programmer? Who else has been doing this? That's my question. Who else has been the programmer? If we've just now learned, or cutting edge research is showing that we have the ability to do this, we've figured out some things on cell functionality to accept, say, higher salinity or higher acidity or change in pH. One of the things coming out of MIT right now that just totally blows my mind is they're admitting that some of this DNA coding can be recoded to accept changes in light.
How do we do that? Meditation, of course, is one way, but what are some ways that you would offer that we can actually begin to make this transformation process with our DNA code?
Well, here's what I'm covering in my book. I want to answer the question, who all has been the programmer? Is it all just environmental changes that are extreme? Or is it extraterrestrials? You know, does it require actual recoding of the DNA by another being? Or is the DNA equipped to change on its own in the presence of catastrophic events? Because what we're not seeing is sudden changes in the recoding of DNA that are happening naturally.
Wow, you're just supplying so much information and very, very articulate. I'm just taking this all in. I have on my list of things to talk about with you the electromagnetic spectrum.
Yeah, I love to talk about the electromagnetic spectrum. Yeah, first of all, the more we understand about the electromagnetic spectrum, the more we're going to understand how to communicate outside of this box that we live in. So everything is surrounded. Everything is the foundation of everything is what I'm trying to get at is light energy. Before there was any matter in the universe, there was light. So that even goes back to biblical teachings. There's all kinds of spiritual teachings that we provide each other that have a commonality. So some people call themselves eclectic and they research all sorts of religious beliefs and they find a commonality in so many of them. And one of the best people who've put that forth to the public has been Dr. Wayne Dyer. I just totally love that guy.
And that man has put me on, listening to his PBS presentations or videos, that man has probably put me on my humbled knees more times than any other teacher I can imagine.
He's awesome.
Yeah. One of my absolute all-time favorites.
But the more we understand about, and let's just think about those two words, electromagnetic, electric and magnetic, and we're talking about light, and then we try to define what light is. So infrared, radio, so we're on a radio broadcast right now. So these radio waves can be like 0.3 meters to 10 meters long. And so if you can just visualize a meter stick or a yardstick and take like that times 10, you've got radio waves that exist that have wavelengths of that size, and we call it light. It is a type of light. We just can't see it with our eyes. We move down the spectrum. We have infrared. We have microwave radiation. As we get into these higher frequencies, notice how our technology has been using a more and more and more. And now we have this problem with frequency interferences that affect our bodies. So it's artificially produced, not coming from stars, but we're utilizing it in technology like cell phones
and microwave ovens.
Now, microwave, if you're on the side of the spectrum where microwaves are a little bit longer, they truly aren't harmful. But as you move down the spectrum where the wavelengths get shorter and you're still in the microwave range, that does become a medical issue. Now, as we go through the spectrum and we get to shorter wavelengths like X-ray, that's why we don't want a lot of exposure to X-ray. We have found it to cause cancer. So these higher frequency intensity light reaches the body, and our DNA programming is not reprogrammed to accept it. Therefore, it damages cells.
So should we stay away from microwave ovens in your findings and your research and the knowledge that you have?
Well, you certainly don't want to stand in front of it.
What about, well, let's say I can operate it from a mile away. What does that do to the food you take it into your body?
Well, the microwave energy is light energy that heats up the water molecules that are in the food. That's a whole other topic that would be really great to explore. However, okay. From physics experiments that I've actually witnessed, microwave radiation energy gets the kinetic energy moving inside the water molecules. So they move faster and faster at a quicker rate to heat up the food. It's my understanding, once the food has been removed, it's not as damaging as you would think to the body. However, the cells of the food have been damaged, therefore the nutrition is no longer very valuable.
Right. And also a heavy dose of grace over your food wouldn't hurt either. Heather, I'm looking at a bullet list of some of the things you wanted to cover today. And I'm just sitting here just enjoying this program. Space program secrets of yesterday. Is that the same thing we were talking about at the opening of the show? Or is that something completely different?
Yeah, secrets of yesterday. So let's go back to the early times of the space program that my father was heavily involved in, especially in the 1960s and 70s and 80s. So you asked me about the far side of the moon, for instance. And I told you, yeah, my dad's talked about that. He said there were large structures that the astronauts witnessed when they were on the moon. And those were already there, pre-existing. Not put there by humans from, you know, our exploration understandings, but had been covered in a lot of lunar dust. And the moon doesn't have much of an atmosphere. There's not a whole lot weather going on the moon. But this dust is very magnetic, and it does stick to things. And over time, it can kind of cover things up, from my understanding. But it is possible that some of this stuff was covered by lunar dust on purpose. Now, I didn't hear that from my dad. That's my own conclusion. But he explained to me these are ancient ruins and that there were some real interesting things that the astronauts witnessed on the moon. One of those astronauts being Edgar Mitchell, who has come forward. He did speak at Contact in the Desert in 2015. He has since passed away. And he was one of the pioneers who has talked about, for instance, the Roswell crash in New Mexico. You should look him up. He has given a lot of information on that topic. He will not tell you anything about the moon, except he has told some people privately some of the things that he witnessed on the moon, as well as Buzz Aldrin and some of the other astronauts that have been involved in lunar landings. And the NASA people in mission control had been exposed, of course, because of images and radio information coming back from the astronauts on the moon, and it was definitely kept hush-hush.
I would think. And for those who are curious, Colonel Blanchard, that was part of the Roswell incident, it's not a past life of mine. Heather, we have about another 6-7 minutes. I would like for you to talk about your passion. Out of all the subjects we talk about, I love when people are in their passion. It just does something to me. What would you like to share with me and our listening audience here at Center of Light Radio? What is something you would like to bring forth in any particular field?
Okay. Well, I like to end this with talking about the importance of manipulating light energy. So all of these waves that pass through us and pass through other matter, we call the light spectrum, you can control and you can use light to your advantage. And you can also use it to your disadvantage. But the love that you give and the love that you radiate to others and the thoughts that are in your mind affect the vibrational and the frequency characteristics of light. So you can actually manipulate the one thing in the universe that is basically controlling all matter as we know it. And keep this in mind. This is, I think, kind of interesting to say. We are only 5% of the universe. And it's not just Earth. It's our entire solar system. It's all the galaxies. You collect everything. There is a very small amount of matter as we know it. Everything else is energy. And matter stems off of energy. Before there was matter, there was energy. I believe before there were electrons, there was heavy, dense matter we call protons and other subatomic particles. But through light, electrons were developed and they put space between things. They put space between atoms and built these structures we called molecules. And the way molecules vibrate, and I'm talking down to the subatomic particles, that vibration is controlled by the environment. And the environment is from our thoughts. And so if you can really control your thoughts, get that under control, think as positively as you can on a regular basis, make it a habit, turn your habits into positive thinking, you can change the way these molecules vibrate. You can change the way light affects things, and you can put things at the right wavelength for the good of all things.
What is the one thing that you mentioned that we can manipulate? I know most people have a problem with that word. They really don't know what it means. But you had mentioned that through getting ourselves together, we can actually begin to manipulate that one thing. What was that you were referring to?
Are we talking about our thoughts?
Well, you said that we have the ability, if we get all our ducks in a row, that we're able to control, to use a word, or to change the one thing that brings everything forth. Or are you saying that we have within us the ability to control the universe? And the reason I brought that up is because in my work, I talk about how when we become connected and we learn how to supplicate, when we learn how to get ourselves together and come into a state of balance, and please, listening audience, don't take this out of the context in which it's intended, that God becomes our slave. Seen in the right context, there's a point. And the point is that because of the unconditional love between Creator and ourselves, everything we ask for, we get. Pro, con, good, bad, in, out, all of it. And because, you know, we're talking about light. And if the universe is a tapestry, and by what we choose to do, we actually affect it, then basically, consciously or unconsciously, we get everything we ask for.
Yeah, it definitely comes back to you. So words are very powerful. But what's more powerful than that is the intention behind the spoken word or thought. You don't have to open your mouth and make noise right. to create something. Your thoughts alone are creating and are more powerful. We give less credit to those thoughts than to spoken word. But those thoughts, I mean, other beings and other dimensions are tuned into that. So you think you're alone in your mind and your thoughts, but you're not. You're not at all. Definitely not. Haven't you ever been in a situation where you can feel the energy from somebody else and you're not even talking to each other, but you just know the condition of that person?
Absolutely. I think pretty much everyone has done that.
Yeah, we feel it all the time. You can be in a place at a certain time. You can walk into a room and you might feel incredibly full of anxiety, or you might feel incredibly full of love, but you have no explanation to that. It's not spoken word, it's thoughts. It's energy from other people. It's combined energy from other people. And the more that we combine these metaphysical opportunities, the more powerful we are. That's why the reptilians work in mass numbers as much as possible.
Heather, we are at the top of the hour. Thank you for being a powerful guest on Center of Light Radio. Do you have a quick final thought for us, dear?
Yeah, it takes a smaller group of love to outdo a very large group of evil. I can tell you that.
Wow, what a great note to end on. Heather, thank you for being on Center of Light Radio. That door is always open to you.
All right. Thank you. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
For sure.
This is a great conversation.
We can do it anytime, love. I'll get back with you soon on some dates. Everyone, Miss Heather Sartain, very articulate, very well together. You can bet I'm going to contact her here shortly for a future date on Center of Light Radio. Monday nights, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, I'm here in this chair doing what I love doing. It's all about doing what you love, and then life gets pretty juicy. For those who are not here at the beginning of the show, Thursday night, I'm going to be doing a Burst of Light live stream event on Facebook. You can go to facebook.com/KeithAnthonyBlanchard, and at 7 o'clock Central Time, you will find a live feed on my wall. Check it out. It's going to be on the practice of meditation, how to do it, and the importance of it. Next week on Center of Light Radio, my guest is going to be Tara Janelle Walsh, spiritual famed author, Neil Donald Walsh's daughter, and we're going to talk about soul courage. I will look forward to seeing you next week here on Center of Light Radio, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Everyone have a wonderful evening, wonderful evening, wonderful evening. And also remember, YouTube channel, Center of Light Radio. Go subscribe to my page. I'd appreciate it greatly. Peace, love, and light to you all. And thank you, Jimbo, for your first time here at Center of Light Radio in the chat, Jim Bob Short. Please come back and see me, my brother, Sonic. Everyone, thank you again in the chat room. Have a wonderful evening. Peace, love, and light.